G'day, everybody, and welcome to Mos Eisley Monthly, your local monthly nerdy version news of Star Wars. I'm your host, MBS, and with me, I got the daggy one. How's everyone doing out there in Facebook land and later on in YouTube land, when you can watch this later on if you've missed the live broadcast tonight? We've got a lot of stuff to get through tonight, so I think we will start it off with Daggy Spot.
All right, so just to clarify for those who don't know what this is, our spots are where we discuss things that we've seen regarding Star Wars in our day-to-day lives when you least expect it. And of course, it's been a month since we were on, so there's actually been a fair bit that sort of popped up, and we have to sort of filter it out to work out what's worth reporting on and what's not. Kind of funny, in my case, even like last night on The Chaser, there was actually a reference to The Empire Strikes Back where the Chaser, who was the Tigress, said that the team was like, I think the host said the team was like the Empire, right? And of course, when they lost the Chaser at the end, she actually said, oh, the Empire struck out. Very good. So that was actually quite funny. A few weeks ago, this is just like complete fluke how these things work. I'm just flicking through channels on the TV and I come across funny car drag racing. Right. And I'm just like, I'm just watching that. No sound on, just watching the cars zipping down the quarter mile. And there was actually a car there called the Stormtrooper. So it was all white with the Stormtrooper thing on it. I thought that's actually kind of groovy. So I don't know how well it did or whatever else. But I mean, you work on the view that Stormtroopers can't shoot straight. So can Stormtroopers drive straight? And being a quarter mile, which isn't meant to be straight, you know, you sort of wonder how that all sort of panned out. But that was actually quite groovy. So like, oh, look, there's the Stormtrooper. How good is that? Now, currently watching a TV series called The Americans, which is set in the early 1980s. And of course, whenever you have a show or a movie that is set in the 80s, the easiest way to set that scene is to have Star Wars stuff added within it. So there's actually in the family, there's a young boy and there's like the teenage daughter. And of course, you're thinking, how do you know this is set in the 80s? And sure enough, he's got a Star Wars bedspread, as you do. He's even got a Star Wars poster on the wall, which is actually from the soundtrack album, which is from the Death Star with all these ships flying around everywhere. Although the keen daggy eye pointed out of the fact that it's a reproduction, not an original, but let's not stress about that, shall we? And one dude had an AT-AT model kit still mint in box in his cupboard for that kid, which was kind of groovy. And of course, if you ever watch things like E.T. and Poltergeist, which were made in the 80s, they have Star Wars stuff chucked in there as well. So that's there was the dead giveaway as to where things were set. And just quickly, I found this on just people are just joining in everywhere here at the moment. It's just absolutely completely madness. Now this one I had this is where YouTube sort of gives me the shits a little bit, right? I found a video on YouTube regarding bloopers from A New Hope when the film was first being made in 1976, and it's all raw footage and there's mistakes and behind the scenes bits, and that's not all mistakes, but it's just a lot of behind the scenes footage. And you read some of the comments from people, and they're all having a go at it, saying, oh, this is why the film looks crap, and, you know, like, how can the thing turn out so well, and it's, like, really, really cheesy and all that. And you sort of, like, want to smack people in the head and go, hang on, if you've ever seen filmmaking in real life, this is how it is. It's slow. It's stagnant. There's no music. There's no sound effects, right? This is how movies are made. And later on in post-production, that's where the magic comes to life. And people were just not getting it. And I was thinking, hang on, this is also 1976. You've got to just allow for that. And I tell you what, I was a bit kind of a bit chitty about that. I didn't say anything. I didn't type any comments. But there are times when you look at what people say, you know, 40 years after the fact, and you just think, you know, people have just got no idea. So if anybody out there ends up watching this video of the outtakes and behind the scenes of A New Hope, cut the thing a bit of slack, because, you know, in real life, that's how movies are made. So anyway, there you go. So there you go. That's over to you.
But that's the same with any film with outtakes. Some of them are hystericals or muck-ups or whatever the case is, and sometimes they're just sitting there. There's one in Deadpool where he sits there for about 3 minutes waiting because the director's waiting for a sound to go past. And, yeah, that's what filmmaking is all about for those who don't know what they do in films. Was the Duna cover, was the bedspread, whatever it was in the show, was it from the 80s or was it just some material that made it from now that they sort of crafted?
No, I don't know. I think they sourced the real one from that era. It was a single bedspread that you could get. Had Star Wars written all over it, and it's actually features prominently. I mean, Aaron is a bit of a fan of the American, which is really, really cool. Geez, a few people have joined us, William and Colin and good old Daniel and all the
Hey,
rest of them.
Jay.
And yeah, I think
Well.
they're smart enough to get things from that era and use them, right? Rather than getting something contemporary and trying to get away with it, because ultimately you've got to try and make these things look as realistic as possible. But I thought it was just cool. He could have had any other bedspread in the entire universe, but sure enough, he had a Star Wars one, and I thought that was kind of groovy. So there you go.
Well, my three little bits of my spots this week are actually all eBay spots. So I've spent a little bit of time on eBay just looking around, seeing what there is, and yeah, I've dipped into the pocket and pulled out a couple of items. And here's the first one, and they're all Jedi related, which it doesn't really. Maybe we should do this one next year, because when the Jedi. No. So
No.
can I have full screen, please, Mr. Daggy?
Okay, there we go. All yours.
So those who were around in the 80s and you remember when we had all the fun, cool toys and everything, do you remember having the little erasers? So I've got a Royal Guard one, and now I've got a Gamorrean Guard one. So it's a little bit of green and brown that I could just rub all over the place. How's that sound?
It's a little rubber, mate. What can I say, eh?
And you could do the splits too, but not very well.
Woo.
Now, from that same era, and this came in the same packaging, those who were collecting the action figures and all that sort of stuff may remember the Jedi collection books, which had all the bits and pieces that were coming out from that time. So,
And
and
as kids, we drooled over that sort of stuff.
oh yeah, and I drooled over it the other day when I got it. And here's the funny thing. You only got it when you bought a vehicle, I think, because they were that sort of thing. But you know how we sort of said, and I've got this set up in Lego, so it's kind of the same. We always wanted the mass forces, Imagine in the commercials we had the, 300 stormtroopers next to the figure and all that sort of stuff. And everyone's going, how do I get that? And you remember when you only had like the one stormtrooper or two and you had to make it out like a whole platoon? This is what we aimed for. And
Yep.
now I have that in Lego. So
You go.
your dreams do come true. What can I say? And then on the other side, for those Ewok collectors, there's all the Ewoks. So you can actually see what.
They were very popular when they came out, and they were very hard to get too, because not all of them were released at the same time.
Oh,
So, yes.
there's a lot of yub nub action there.
Yeah.
And then the best part about it was the list where you went got,
Yeah.
want, got, want, got.
Yeah. I
So
like what Colin has said. Did the book come with its own drool from people who drooled over it in the past? So there you go.
well, it's in fairly good condition, believe it or not. It's not
Yeah.
as bad from a book from 1983. So
Yeah.
yeah, I finally have one of those because I can't remember what happened with
There you
mine.
go. There's a line to write down for us.
There it is
Great.
too. And the final thing, and someone may be able to clarify this for me. I believe it's just a UK production or a UK release is the helmet collection. There's a bit of reflection, I'm sorry, guys and girls. But the helmet collection that's more recent, which came with a magazine. Now,
Right.
here's the question. Here's the question. Now, there's a whole stack of these. So if you have a look at the back of the magazine,
Oh,
there's
you
you can
still
get the
got
next
one?
issue, which is the
Yeah.
Tusken Raider and all that sort of stuff. So it comes with a magazine, it comes with the helmet. Here's the question. You can put us back together, dude. Who wants me to open it? Because it's technically still
Oh,
in its packaging. I can open
no.
it because it's got its own little box, but I want to open it. Who wants me to open it?
No.
Yeah. We'll have a
No.
vote. I'll open it.
If anybody says yes, open it, they're all heathens. So they don't deserve to be on the show. No, I can't say don't deserve to be on the show, because that's not the we want the audience to be on the show. So there you go. There.
So there you go. They're my three little spots for the week, and in addition to the Royal Guard collection I got.
Yeah. Actually, it's very funny, Aaron. Whenever you come to this sort of stuff, the biggest gag was always who gets the job of opening up all these packets to get these action figures, because you'd have to do them all one at a time. So 200 Lobots, mate, that's a lot of Lobots. Jeepers creepers.
And
Look,
that would have
Catherine,
been the.
I can open it, mate. This is not, oh, disgraceful. You're not gonna, are you? All right, just for you, I'll give you the full screen. You're gonna have to do it quickly though.
Oh, you want me to open it? All right.
No, I don't want you to open it, but the crowd, I'm going by the judgment of the audience, and the audience is like, make their point heard.
All right. So, I may need hospitalization after this for some reason, but we'll see what happens.
It's going to come down to, here's one you prepared earlier. Look, we can't even see what you're doing, mate.
Yeah, I know. Hang on. I just have to give the... Oh, I can smell the collectible. I can feel it dying in my hands.
Too late, Angie. Angie just said, don't do it. It's too late now.
Sorry, Angie, it's too late. It's already kind of open. So.
Hang on. For the audience out there, can you actually even smell the value just dissipating before your very eyes?
I can, and it's a really weird smell.
It's a smell of like valuelessness.
There it is.
Yeah, very good.
Look, it even comes apart too. So,
Well, the damage is done now. You can do whatever you want with it. So, there you go.
A box reveal just for everyone.
I'm going to have to remove myself from this screen as I just sit there and cry my eyes out. It's like vandalism, clickable vandalism, just doing that. So, anyway, so there you go. Catherine, it's much nicer without the box. Doesn't matter. In the box, it's worth millions in the future. Anyway, so we move on.
Bill, it smelled like something. Victory, I'm not so sure if it was that. So, there we go. All right, so we're going to move on to our first topic, which is comparing the Star Wars despecialized edition versus the revisited version versus the Phantom Edit. Now, if that wasn't a sentence and a half or a mouthful, then I don't know what is. We're going to do a quick presentation about something relating to that first, and then we'll get on to the comparisons of why they're different. So if you could, please share the screen, Mr. Daggy. So we're going to run through a bit of a timeline of what happened with the versions of A New Hope. And we're going to stick with A New Hope at this stage.
We've got a question from Colin. How much did you pay for the helmet, dude?
I think it was about $20 or $22, something like that. It was like £15, something like that. So it wasn't very much, but they're quite rare. I haven't seen any before. All right, so back to this. So we all know A New Hope came out in 1977 and the world was all well and good. The theatrical re-release subtitled A New Hope in 1981 when it came out. In 1985, it was released to video, home video. I'm not going to read the entire lot of these, but in 1989, it was released on Laserdisc. And here's an interesting thing, if you read that down the bottom. To fit on the one single disc, the film was sped up by 3%. So if you can tell the difference between a film that's been sped up by 3% and not, then you're better the person than I am. In 93, it was released on Laserdisc as a definitive collection with new audio. And each time they did everything, they upgraded it, they changed or added or fixed or did bits to it. Then in 1985, the original trilogy released on VHS. And Laserdisc with the THX audio. We should all remember those because I think they were the blue video covers for memory.
Yep.
Then we had the 97 special editions, which came out January through March, the 20th anniversary of A New Hope. But we had all three films come out at that stage with the additional footage and... I think there was more footage in A New Hope than there was in the other two combined for memory.
Yeah, the original idea of the special edition was meant to be a celebration of Star Wars turning 20, and they realised once they started the first movie, they realised, oh, hang on, we can muck around with the other two as well. And that's the reason why Empire and Jedi got a bit of a workover, but it was mainly for A New Hope.
Yeah. And so they then came out later on video. Then in 2004, the first DVD release of the films. Including the replacing of the Latin script text with, you have to say that, dude, because I can never remember how to pronounce.
It's Orabesh.
Orabesh. And apparently they also updated a little bit on Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith later on. 2006 DVD editions, the reissue of the original trilogy, with unaltered versions on bonus discs. Now, I don't remember there being unaltered versions on bonus discs.
Here's a comment I've got to put in. This is an absolute classic. Luke sounds even more. This is 3% higher. that's a good one, Aaron. Well done, son. Yep.
Very good. And so they continued on with the 2011 Blu-ray release with alterations to all six films then. And I think it was around that time we saw the 3D version of episode one, which was pretty awful. For those who saw it, there was only about six or seven shots in there that were digital 3D, not, you know, at your face type 3D, not like woo 3D. But once Disney brought out Lucasfilm, that was pretty much it. Those went bye bye. They changed the fanfares for the 2015 digital releases for the streaming services. And in 2019, the 4K Ultra High D versions of everything except for Solo and Last Jedi at this stage. So that's what they've done with the films over the years. And because of that, other people haven't been very impressed with those versions, so they've done their own.
All right. So... you want me to take over?
Yeah, let's go for it.
All right, cool. So as MPS mentioned, there are effectively three different concepts of fans doing editing of the actual movies themselves. So in chronological order, it effectively starts with the Phantom Edit, and I'll get to that in a second. As MPS mentioned, the despecialized edition, which just this as a name is just bizarre unto itself, and the revisited version, okay, as well. So these are actual people who've gotten the actual movies and then just chopped them all up accordingly. Now, I'll start with the easiest one of the lot, which is the Phantom Edit. So for those who don't know, after the Phantom Menace came out in 1999, there was a lot of backlash for the film. A lot of people didn't like it. It wasn't very successful. The thing eventually comes out on videotape, and an editor, a professional editor, got it and chopped it up and changed the concept of the story completely. And at the time, nobody knew who it was who'd done this, right? It was a complete mystery. Some people even thought it was Kevin Smith. And Kevin Smith had said, look, he'd seen the edit, but he actually wasn't the one who did it. And it turned out they discovered later on it was an American editor called Mike Nichols. He was the one who was responsible. And he actually listed it as episode 1.1. Now, of course, you couldn't buy it. You had to know how to download it, you know, back in the a dozen plus years ago. And so it was very, very hard to find. But his key changes, and there was quite a fair bit of them actually, was primarily cutting out 18 minutes of the original runtime. He toned down all of Jar Jar's antics, took all the silliness out of him, made him a lot more of a serious character. All of Anakin's yippies and all these, you know, childish moments were all removed. The references to the midichlorians were all taken out. A lot of the political stuff was cut down. Even some of the deleted scenes were put back in to sort of help explain the story a bit more. And a lot of people actually said it came out, for those who saw it, said it came out really, really good. It actually worked and was actually a bit more of a harmonious story, and it worked as a production. But of course, it was all done, you know, off the cuff, and it wasn't officially released or endorsed or anything like that. So that was one of the first examples of a fan, if you will, going in there and making changes to an already copyrighted product, which is pretty, you know, unheard of, really. And in fact, as it turned out, the same editor did a similar thing to Attack of the Clones. And he actually named it Attack of the Phantom because he was known as the Phantom Editor at this point. And he took out 38 minutes worth of footage from Attack of the Clones. And apparently that has made the film better as well. There's a lot of stuff that got removed, a lot of subplots that got removed. And that was sort of effectively the start of it, if you will. And I think even at that point, no one thought of the idea of like re-editing existing films. You're sure you can make music video clips and, you know, have your favorite moments, but to actually rechange it completely was considered unheard of. Now, that then brings us to the concept of the despecialized edition and the revisited versions. Now, they're both fan edits, yet they are complete polar opposites in their concepts. The despecialized edition is an attempt to get a high def version of the original released films, okay, as they were released in the 70s, 1980 and 1983, right, because they were never released properly on Blu-ray or DVD or not properly done. They're trying to get the actual release, whereas the revisited version is a guy who's trying to fix the films up and remove or sort out, take all of the special edition rubbish out, and then clean them up, fix up all the continuity mistakes, add in extra scenes and whatever else, and to try and make the films the way they should have been, as has been announced. So to give an indication as to where these things came from, so the despecialized edition was actually a project from a guy in the Czech Republic of all places, and his name is, now I can't pronounce it in Czech, so I'm going to get this wrong, Peter Hamáček, but he goes under the name of Harmony, that's right. And what he did is he put the word out all around the world and was able to get all these different versions of the film from Blu-ray, DVD and whatever else, and he was trying to produce a high-def version, right, because prior to that there was no high-def version. DVD is not high-def. DVD is standard-def. And was able to assemble, effectively, a complete version of the original 1977 release of the film using some footage from the Blu-rays, upscaling some of the DVDs and getting footage from other places. And this includes the soundtrack, because if you know the movies, they change a lot of the audio as well. You know, certain lines are changed, certain sound effects are changed and whatever else. So he's trying to put the movies back the way they were. And there's now a version of each of the three of the original trilogy, A New Hope, Empire and Jedi. And you have to know where to look to find these things. You can't buy them. They're not officially released, obviously. Apparently, Lucasfilm and Disney have just been quiet about it. They haven't said anything. And if you are interested, you can look these up on Wikipedia. There's actually a despecialized section in Wikipedia. And you have to know where to go to be able to download these things, because these are big files. We're talking like, you know, 12 gig, whatever else, 18 gig. But if you want to see the films in high def as they were originally released, that's effectively the only way you can do it. And the concept behind it is actually very, very clever, I think, to say, well, if there's no official release, I'll make my own, effectively. And that's what's happened. And I personally, myself, the despecialized version of A New Hope is the one that I'll watch. If I'm going to put one on, that's the one I go for, because it is the way the film looked when I first saw it back in 1977. I haven't seen The Empire and the Jedi once, but I assume it's a similar sort of thing. So despecialized means they're not the special edition versions. They've been brought back a bit. That then takes us to the other point, the other side, to the revisited thing. Now, there's a guy, I don't know if he's actually announced his name at all, but he goes by the name of Adiwan, and he's based in England. And for the past, 10 years now, he's been going through and fixing up what started with A New Hope, and then he's gone on to Empire and to Jedi as well. And what he is doing is trying to fix the faults from the DVDs and the Blu-rays, the ones that MPS mentioned earlier, all these different variations, all the changes, removing them and then fixing his own versions. Right. So if you know the movies well enough, you'll know that when you watch them, there's a million mistakes. They're just production mistakes. You know, there's continuity errors. There's oil stains swapping sides and lightsabers that don't have the right colors and things, you know, you can see sticks popping out of the ground here, and, you know, TIE fighters that aren't flying properly and the colors that are all wrong. And he's gone through and made a change to all this to try and fix all these things. Now, when you watch this stuff, it is extremely hardcore. I mean, it's almost like going frame by frame through the entire movie and just changing all these things that nobody would ever even notice. And you kind of got to ask yourself, well, what's the point of that? You know, it's like changing Starfields, for example, you know, because the original Starfield didn't look too good, so you change the Starfield, adding in things behind shots. And you do have to wonder what's the mindset for it. But it's become so popular now that he's actually gone through Empire and he's going through Jedi. And ironically, with A New Hope, because he did that in standard def, he's now going back and doing it again. This is just for the first movie, to try and get into high def. And as he's doing that, he's making additional changes to it. And you can actually find, and if you go to YouTube, there's all these videos regarding the work he's done. And you kind of got to ask yourself, it's like, well, how far is too far? You know, before you start going through and you go, you know what? Why have you done that? It's like, what's the point? And you can actually find a listing of all the changes he's made for some of these things. And it's so intricate. It's a labor of love that I think may have gone too far. And of course, now what's happening with the Return of the Jedi version is he's now getting donations from people so he can now film extra scenes, mainly the B-Wing pilots, which are all cut out of Return of the Jedi. You don't see B-Wing pilots at all, really. And he's filming new scenes of his own actors and his own sets to reinsert into Return of the Jedi to fill that out. And, of course, then you've got to say, well, okay, are you changing too much? Is this getting a little out of hand? And that's, in short, what it's all about. And, of course, I'm curious to see, because he doesn't own the copyright to any of this stuff, will somebody then come in and go, you know what, I don't agree with those changes. I'm now going to change his changes from the original movies. So in short, that's what it's all about. And some people love the revisited versions, even though with A New Hope, he did made a couple of really contentious changes. So when Obi-Wan and Vader are fighting in the lightsaber duel, I think he added in Duel of the Fates or Battle of the Heroes, or added in music that was never there. And I reckon that was like, oh, that's a bit contentious. So I think you've got to ask yourself, okay, well, do you just change existing stuff, or when do you start adding in brand new material that you filmed yourself? So that's it in a summary. So regarding fan edits, and you do have to wonder what's the point? Is it necessary?
I think Michelle's question is relevant. Do you think you'll ever be satisfied with finished product? And by the sounds of it, no.
Well, yeah, when you look at some of the shots, there's a lot of, to the guy's credit, especially for the revisited stuff, you can look it up online or on YouTube. There's a lot of before and after shots. And it was interesting to sort of compare the original Blu-ray of A New Hope, his version of A New Hope, where he changed a certain thing, and then he would go back and change it again for the updated version, the high-def version. And you do wonder, you're right, you go, well, will he go back again and try and do a 4K version and then change it one more time? And look, to be fair, the work is outstanding. I mean, it is like super professional, and it's really, really well done. It's taken the guys years to do this material. To the point where you sort of think, does it make the film better? I think the answer is no. I think, you know, if a spaceship, like, for example, I'll use the escape pod from A New Hope, right? When it shoots out of the Star Destroyer, in the original movie, it sort of goes downwards, and in his version, it goes sort of straight across. So the arc is a bit more correct, right? Does it make it a better movie? Well, I don't think so. You know, if the lightsabers are the right color, all like absolutely perfect now, does that make it a better movie? I don't know. And, of course, you compare this to the despecialized edition, where they've been deliberately put back to the way they were originally with all the faults included. It's really quite bizarre. So there you go.
So in the despecialized edition,
yep,
one of the faults that I remember is when you see Vader walking over Obi-Wan's cloak just after he's cutting with the lightsaber. Now, if I remember correctly, his lightsaber wasn't rotoscoped, and you just see the white stick. Is that
right.
Is that in that version?
Yep. So if you know your movies and you sort of bought the Blu-ray or the DVD and they fixed things, so they kept the original version of the film, it would be this special edition, fair enough, and they cleaned it all up, that's now all been removed and put back the way it was originally. And that's the funny thing about it. So it's actually putting all the faults back in. All the mistakes have all been put back in. And I really respect that, because they're not trying to say, oh, we'll do a high-def version of the best version. We'll do a high-def version of the original version. Warts and all, every mistake put back in. And I think there's a lot to be said about that. And I think you could probably poll people and say, well, which version do you prefer and why? Now, I've said I would always go for the despecialized version, because that's the version I remember, okay? And that's the version that I saw. And even though I know all the faults and I see all the mistakes, it's part of the charm of how the films were made. They don't have to be technically perfect to make them better pictures. And, of course, once people start tinkering with things, you start looking at them and go, oh, I see they fixed this, they fixed that. Daniel's made a point of saying that the Battle of Yavin was one of the biggest changes in A New Hope. And, of course, one of the things that occurred in that film is the guy added the Yavin planet in the background in a lot of the spaceship scenes. So the X-Wings are flying around, you sort of see it added in. And it just gives you a bit of a context, you know. It's like, oh, okay, there's the planet over there. In the original version, you didn't see that. But did that matter? Is that important? I don't know. So technically it's correct, but whether that makes it a better thing, I don't know. So it's really, really quite interesting. But when you look at the workmanship and what's being involved, what's been put into these things for the revisited versions, you do wonder. It's like, that's a lot of time and effort that only the hardcore fans will be keen on, because you can't buy this thing anywhere, right? You have to know how to download it. And that's why I was wondering, it's like, how many changes are too many changes before you start changing the core essence of what the thing actually was? And there's no right or wrong, right? Okay, there's no like, this guy, 81's correct and Harmony's wrong. It doesn't really matter. It's each their own. But I know Daniel prefers the revisited editions, and I think fair enough too. They're well worth watching, but as to whether they're the better version, I don't know. It's an interesting one. So there you go.
I think an interesting question would be, well, what would happen if Lucasfilm had have done what everyone asked for and re-released them the originals, mistakes and all, in a high def version, this guy wouldn't have done the work.
Well, the thing with the special editions is that they obviously said, let's improve and fix a few things, but they were never going to go to the level of detail that what the revisited versions did. You know, they're saying, oh, well, how about we add Yavin in the back of the X-Wings? They go, who cares? I mean, does it really matter? Like, as I said, does it make the film better? No, it doesn't, right? It's just an extra bit of detail. I mean, sure, you can fix certain mistakes, and a classic was The Empire Strikes Back, where the Imperial officers at the end were flipped over. Sure, they flip them back again, and they sort that out. Yeah, fair enough. But for a lot of things, you go, well, what's the return on investment? Okay, if I spend all this time, I've got to pay someone, physically pay someone to say, I want the ship to go this way instead of that way. Is it worth doing? And in the end, the answer is probably no. And then people watch those versions and go, why didn't they fix that? Because clearly it is an obvious mistake. But in the end, it's not really worth it. To have someone go in and go, well, okay, they didn't fix the official versions, I'll fix it for them. And going from there. And, of course, there's all these issues with colour grading and everything else. The colours were all wrong, so this guy went and refixed a lot of the colours. And, yeah, fair enough to you. I get that. But you could never – all the changes he made for the films to make them technically perfect, to pay people to do that, it would have pushed the budget way beyond the realms of what it'll be worth doing. So Catherine, you're right. George Lucas, he was never into the once the special editions came out to him, they were the – official versions. Okay, so the prior versions, it just didn't matter. That's the reason why all the prints for A New Hope and Empire and Jedi were all destroyed in 1996, because special edition was the version. So there you go. Oh yeah, that's right, Daniel. He had the Imperial March in A New Hope as well, where the TIE fighters first appear. Yeah, okay. So there you go. Running into a door name was here. So yeah, and that's sort of it. So it's interesting sort of stuff, and it does generate a lot of debate. And of course, a lot of fans, they're looking at this stuff going, why didn't the official movies do this? Why does it take a fan to fix all these problems? And of course, that's why it comes down to that question. It's like, well, do these problems need to be fixed? Sure, it's great that they're fixed, and it's handy. And some of them, as I said, some of the changes, you go, Jesus, I wouldn't have thought that. I mean, a classic example, I didn't see this, I just read about it, right? Luke's hanging upside down in the Wampa Cave in Empire Strikes Back. Apparently, depending on which shot you're looking at, his legs are split in different positions. So when he's hanging up in the ice, he's like this, and in the close-up, they're like that. So he's now fixed it so it matches up. And you go, really? I was like, is that important? So, yeah, it's just crazy stuff. So, anyway. So,
yeah. I suppose it's like one of us walking up to, like, a Picasso and trying to fix it, you know, and going, well, does it need to be fixed? You know, it's been there. You know, it's been there for so long, it doesn't matter if it's got faults in it. It's what it is.
So that's the other thing with the revisited thing. If you're fixing an on-screen mistake, all right, that's fine. But when you're adding in your own material, as was mentioned with the extra TIE fighters and the new filming of the new B-Wing scenes, well, then is that going, like, beyond the realms of, like, what you should be allowed to do? Sure, I see something on screen and I'll fix up the error and I'm done. But when I go, oh, no, I'm going to film a brand-new bit of my own people, my own set, and I'm going to insert that in, that then is opening the door for other people to go, you know what, I don't agree with that change. I'm going to do my own revisited and take that out, you know, because I don't agree with it. And there's just opening up this massive can of worms as to how far this can go once other people go, you know, I don't agree with what this dude's doing. And I think that's heading into a very, very interesting territory, because once you start down that path and you go, you know what, we filmed this scene with these B-Wing guys and it worked great. Let's film some other stuff in the forest now. And it becomes a fan film type thing, and you insert in fan film material, because that's effectively what it is. It's fan film material being inserted into the real movies. And that is heading down to dangerous territory in my view. So there you go.
Yeah, Catherine, if you wanted to change it, he probably could have. It sort of reminds me of when someone says to me, oh, when do you know that your script is done for a film? And you go, when you've shot it, edited it, and premiered it. Because that's it, because the script continually changes, whereas, you know, like a film, once it's finished, is usually finished. You know.
Well, the argument's always been films are never finished, they're just abandoned, right? That's always been the school of thought. And, yeah, there are clearly things that occur with these pictures, and you go, you know what, there's mistakes. We see them on screen, we have a bit of a laugh about them, and you go, you know what, it's just part of the charm of what makes it what it is. If the film was technically perfect, does it make it a better film? And I think the answer, it really doesn't matter either way. I agree with you, Daniel. It does show you what people can do. And 81, he clearly spends a lot of time and energy, years and years and years, putting these things together. And he doesn't work in the industry. I know that. And the fundraising he's doing is not to pay for himself. It's just to pay for the sets and the catering for these film shoots. But you almost think it's the amount of hours spent laboring over screens, changing someone else's work, someone else's production for potentially very little, if any, recognition except from major fans. You do wonder if it's like, well, why? I can understand doing A New Hope. A New Hope is a labor of love for a lot of people. You fix it, you change it, you do whatever, right? But then you go to Empire, then you go to Jedi, then you go back to A New Hope to try and get upscaled to a high def. And, of course, you probably do it for the other two movies. I don't know. You kind of got to wonder what the motivation is. And whereas the other guy, ironically, Harmy, who did the despecialized edition, actually ended up getting a job as an editor or a visual effects guy in the film industry. So it worked out well for him. So there you go.
And Aaron, I don't know the answer to that, but Harmy did work on projects like Blade Runner 2049, mm-hmm. Yeah, and Wonder Woman. So it's just because Aaron mentioned Blade Runner.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And trouble is, when they originally saw these things again, the thing with brightness and audio, Well, that's right. I mean, one of the big issues that has occurred, and both, I think you'll find the both guys involved with this would argue that all the official releases, the Blu-rays, the DVDs, have had a lot of faults. There's been a lot of issues with changes that fans did not like, changes to the music, changes to the sound effects, changes to dialogue. I remember when Luke in the special edition, after R2 gets spat out of the swamp thing on Dagobah, he used to say, you're lucky you don't taste very good. And then they changed the line to, you're lucky to get out of there. And you go, why did they change that? There was nothing wrong with that line. And, of course, changing Boba Fett's voice, into the New Zealand type accent, all these sort of things. And a lot of the color changes. I mean, we know a couple of people who've looked at, the Blu-ray versions and everything looks blue. There's a blue tint on everything. And you go, hang on, it never used to look like that. So some of the official releases have sort of spurred this action in the first place and caused a lot of angst with fans who say, okay, I've got the latest Blu-ray. It's the official Lucasfilm release. They put it in, watch on the TV and go, that looks terrible. It's actually made the thing worse rather than improved on it. And I guess that's the reason why a lot of these things have sort of happened in the first place. So, but I can't imagine any other film series getting this sort of treatment from fan edits. But I think it does bring up the point of saying what happens when a person says, I would rather watch what this dude in his house has put together than watch the one that I bought from JB Hi-Fi. And I reckon there's probably something in that for all of us. So there you go.
Yeah, and I think you're right with how many other sort of franchises would do this sort of thing. I don't think there are any others. And it's the same with fan films. I think Star Wars has more fan films than any other franchise. Would you agree with that?
Star Trek would be next, but in terms of quantity, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So exactly. Just wait till someone starts re-editing fan films and making changes on those. That'll be the interesting thing.
So, Aaron, you've asked the question of how many editions are there. So with Blade Runner, there's officially released editions, the theatrical, the special, the extended, the directors, whatever. With Star Wars, they make tinkering changes between versions on a DVD. I mean, even in the official cinematic release was changed. So from the first 77 release to when it got re-released in 1980, right, with a New Hope title. As far as the world is concerned, they're both the same version, right? So if you're talking about tinkering changes, Star Wars has a lot of changes, but in terms of official names, there's only two. There's the theatrical release and the special edition, and that's it, right? Even though we know that there's all these others in between. So that's the main difference. With Blade Runner, they have special names. So that's the difference. So, and of course, yeah, it's all getting a bit out of control. So, and you're right, Michelle, the work on the revisited stuff's come to a halt at the moment because of the COVID restrictions. So that's the thing. And you can learn about all this stuff just by having a bit of a read and just seeing what people have to say. But I'll tell you what, if you haven't heard, especially with the revisited stuff, if you get a check on YouTube and do before and afters and look at the list, there's actually lists on the website where you can actually see all the changes. Some of it will, make you scratch your head and you go, yeah, righto. It's like I can't imagine even, your normal day-to-day life whether you would go to that level of detail just to fix something because it's, really, really obscure. And it's almost like you're looking for faults. Yeah, I don't know. So, But yeah, and it'd be very tricky. I reckon it'd be quite funny if someone said, oh, I'll get the revisited version and I'll remove all of this dude's effects to try and get it back to the specialized version. Oh my God. So, yeah.
They should have a competition to say, all right, who can change the film the least, but make it different in the shortest time frame, and just see, because obviously if these guys take years to do it, then that's one thing. But if you did it in, say, 6 months and you could change it, then that would be a whole completely different story. But
And I mean, the funny thing is that Aaron, the thing is, even with the despecialized versions, there's multiple versions, right? Because they've obviously put together version one, and then they get extra footage and they make version two. There's a, like, even with the New Hope, Empire and Jedi, they've both got version 2. Something, okay. So there's not just one version of that. There's extra, because they're able to fix things better and better as they go along. And I think that the irony is, of course, that if you watch the despecialized version, unless you actually know what the file name is and you put it on for somebody, you'll never know, because it's just a high def version of the original movie. There's nothing in there that indicates what it is. And I reckon that's actually kind of groovy. So the fact that someone's gone to the trouble to do that is pretty cool, really. It's almost like saying you're trying to undo what was done to put things back the way they were without telling anybody that you've done it. I reckon that's kind of cool. So, and I think they're actually released in a way that you can put them onto DVD disc or Blu-ray. They can't do DVD; they have to be Blu-ray. So they're actually already formatted, so they can be put onto a Blu-ray disc, so you can play them on a Blu-ray player if you know where to find them. So there you go. So yeah, it's funny stuff. It really, really is. So yeah.
So I think maybe the whole conclusion of this is, if you want the actual proper version that's not despecialized or revisited or anything like that, you have to get the 1993 laser disc with the original trilogy on it. And if you can find a laser disc with that and a laser disc player that works, well done.
But the problem with that, of course, as you said, it's 3% faster than the normal version. So in reality, unless you go back to the VHS versions, because in the versions of that you brought up earlier, there was one, the versions of the VHS tapes for the original trilogy released from England prior to the THX version being released. But of course, it's videotapes, so on modern day TVs, it doesn't really work. So, but yeah, and of course, people will always argue, and there'll always be box sets coming out, especially with the new movies being released and whatever else. Can they just produce and release the original versions untouched? And of course, that just is never going to happen, and there'll always be people tinkering with these things till the end of time. So that's the that's what's so frustrating about it. PJ, how about the WoW promo? I don't know where you would find that now. Wouldn't be surprised if that's on YouTube. WoW, for those who didn't know, was actually a demonstration disc for the THX home theater system. So if you had a home THX system in your house, you could play the WoW trailers, just all these movies, and just hear the sound. So actually, Grant Umahara was involved with that when he was working at Skywalker Ranch back in 1993. So there you go. So, yes, you are right. If you're going to put on a movie of Star Wars, you go, which version do you want, DVD, Blu-ray, VHS, this version, that version, and they'll all have these little tiny changes in the middle. So it's a bit of a killer. So if you prefer your untouched virginal versions, then despecialized is the way to go. But if those mistakes really give you the shits and you go, you know what, I can't handle the fact that Boba Fett's flipped around and this and that, revisited is the one to look at. So there you go. And good as that.
Maybe one day we'll have a listing that we can actually choose from, where they'll all be on some sort of digital format and you can watch whatever version you want and, you know, go from there. And if you really want to have a Star Wars marathon and you watch all 27 versions of A New Hope one after the other in every different version, then that could be an interesting challenge too.
Because I can't imagine anybody would say, oh, yes, I want the 2003 DVD version where the Ewoks now blink, you know, or it's like, I can't understand why anybody would say, yeah, that is the version that's my preference. I really want to watch that. I think it's either go for the original untouched version or the really, really advanced, highly mucked around version, which is the revisited stuff. And they're the two you'd pick. I can't imagine you pick sort of something in the middle. No, that doesn't seem to make a great deal of sense. I mean, I don't know many people who prefer the special edition of any of the movies over the original ones. I mean, at the time, it was like revolutionary. It's like, oh, my God, we've got, you know, Rontos and Jabba the Hutt's been put back in and all that. But I think in retrospect, people have now said, yeah, nah, we're over it. Get us back to the original version. But, of course, you can't get a proper version of the original movie in high def. It just doesn't exist. So, and as PJ said, even 4x3 in pan and scan, you know, that was the way to go. So, yeah, It's a bit of a shit. It shouldn't. The thing is, you shouldn't have to have this problem in the first place. Should have been one movie, one release, done, right? And unfortunately, there's not. And these people having to try and fix these things up in two different ways: one to fix the mistakes, and one to remove the mistakes. So it shouldn't be like that. So it's crazy. So there you go.
I think what the big shame is Lucasfilm hasn't done it. You know, if they had done it, imagine how many more versions they could have had. They could have had both versions, sold them both, and people would have bought them both.
Well, that was the problem, because when there was a whole lot of fan outrage saying we want the original versions released on DVD or Blu-ray or whatever it was, Lucasfilm did it begrudgingly, right? They said under sufferance, all right, fine, we'll release the original 70, 80, 83 release of the movies, but they were done in really, really poor quality. The transfer was really, really poor, and a lot of people were up in arms over that. And I know even I was considering buying them on DVD because I thought, oh, well, I actually want them on disc, the actual theatrical releases, but I'd heard that the quality transfer was horrendous, because all the focus was on the special edition version. And as a result, people were up in arms over it. And I think that's probably one of the reasons why these versions now exist. And, yeah, and that's sort of just gone from there. Even at the time. Yeah, right, Catherine. At the time, when they first came out, the special editions, it was A New Hope had all the focus. And I guess a lot of people, it was all smoke and mirrors, right? People go, oh, my God, look at this, like, digital fantastic stuff. They've made these changes, but very quickly people realized, yeah, you know what, and some of it was pretty stupid, you know, like when they're going into Mos Eisley and the robot smacks the other robot on the head and all this sort of stuff, and the Jawa falling off the Ronto, and you're going, oh, it's a bit wanky, and putting Jabba back in, totally unnecessary, you know, Boba Fett turned into the camera. It's like, yeah, you're right. I think that it was very short-lived in terms of its popularity. So, and Empire and Jedi weren't too bad, though, even though a lot of people were didn't think the Wampa stuff was necessary. But anyway, there you go.
I liked in A New Hope the extra footage at the Battle of Yavin, because they had more ships, and that sort of, to a point, it was like, well, hang on, this is a small rebellion, and then all of a sudden you had a lot more ships, and you went, hang on a second, this is awesome, because now you've got far more ships to play with, because you sort of looked at it and went, really, the Death Star could have wiped them out in minutes, but now it became a bit more of a battle. But I didn't think that the Jabba stuff needed to be in there. I thought that was a complete.
Yeah. It's a good point. For me personally, sorry, I'm just going to say, for me personally, if I could have gotten the original theatrical release from 1977, get it right to the point where the ships are about to take off from Yavin, and then cut to the special edition, perfect, because you're right. The Battle of Yavin in the special edition, that was outstanding. That was one thing that they really did do an excellent job on. So, yeah.
The only thing that I didn't like about that still is the clock counter. It always confuses me because I can't tell if it's just. But one of the versions that we were discussing actually has a different sort of clock counter in it that I saw for some of the images. Yeah. So that could be different. But yeah.
Yeah, you're right. It says, you know, we'll be in range in 15 minutes, and it doesn't even say 15 minutes. I bet the revisited 30. Version is fixed. So, they tend to focus on stuff like that. William said that had the extra Biggs and Luke scenes in it. Yeah, that probably is, actually. I don't know if those deleted scenes can now be found, and I guess somebody's probably put them back in.
They're on one of the Blu-ray sets, I think, from memory. I think they were in the one that came out a couple of years ago. But at least it was Don Bees that was in the Boba Fett suit for that special edition, wasn't it?
Yep. There's a whole funny story about how he got involved with that. So, yes.
Yeah. I thought he was in the New Hope one.
No, that's not him. He's only in the Return of the Jedi version. So, yes, there you go. And that was only just put in at the last minute in Return of the Jedi. We see Boba Fett in the special edition. So Don had to run back and get a Boba Fett suit and put it on. And, of course, the backpack was the version from Jedi which had been smashed. There's a big bash line across the back, and he had to try and twist it. He's body, so you couldn't see it on camera, but apparently that's it's still visible. So there you go. You could argue. Sorry, go on. What?
I was gonna say maybe one of these guys fixed it.
Yeah. Well, you know what? You just don't know, actually. And I think, you know, one of the things that we've done, we did this a couple of episodes ago where we talk about continuity mistakes in the movies, right? You know, there's no snow prints and the torn and the AT-AT's been pushed over, whatever. And then, of course, the revisited things have got all that fixed up now. They're all being corrected. And it's good to see. Look, there's a part of me that says, you know, it's good to see the mistakes corrected. As I said, I don't know if you need to do it, But the fact that someone's done it, yeah, good on them, you know. And if anything, you're not even watching the movie, you're just looking for all the changes. You're going, I know there's a mistake right here. Oh, he's fixed that one. I know that there's a mistake right there. Oh, he's fixed that one too. Oh, hang on, he's added a bit in here. You remember in the Empire one we had where the Imperial officer runs up to the dude and said, you know, rubber ships are coming into our sector, and the other guy says, oh, our first catch of the day. Well, there were two guys off to the right-hand side not doing anything. Well, he removed all those two and just made the windows bigger and, you know, little things like that. Technically, it looks much better. Doesn't make them film better, but visually it does make it more important. It does sort of line up a bit more, so that's kind of groovy. Yeah, so, yeah, Daniel said it revisited. They did fix the clock, yeah. I reckon that's actually quite funny, so... there you go. But unbelievable. So there you go. It's enough to do your head in, buddy. You thought people out there, Star Wars was easy. It's bloody complicated, mate. And it didn't need to be complicated. And, yes, there will probably be extra versions released when there's more box sets coming out and this and that and that and this. And
when they and wait till they release the Calvin timeline and the Prime timeline.
That's, yeah, anyway. So, and, of course, the other thing is, changes that were added, and you go, okay, Ewoks blinking. You know, some people crack the shits over that. They go, oh my god, the Ewoks can't blink. It's like, well, it's not that big a deal, really. It gives them a little bit of life, and it's like, you know, but you know, to the best of my knowledge, the revisited version, the blinking's being removed or it's being toned down. So it's like, oh god, it's crazy, isn't it? Absolutely crazy.
Are they sending messages like, help me, I'm in trouble, get wicked?
Yeah.
Blinking has like Morse code for the eyes.
Yeah, exactly right. So, it's funny stuff. So, I don't know. But anyway, as I said, you have to look this stuff on BitTorrents or whatever else, and some big downloads, that's for sure. So, but the fact I just found it amusing that the dude had gone all the trouble to fix up A New Hope, and he's got to go back and do it again to do it in HD because it was done in 720p, and it was like, and now he has to read. So he's about halfway through. Excuse me. And he thought, oh, while I'm at it, I can fix bits. I'll give you a classic example, right? So in the start of A New Hope, this is an easy one, right? We tilt down to Tatooine, right? I think it's in that scene. Might even be the scene with the Star Destroyer. Anyway, he's added in the two suns, Tatoo 1 and Tatoo 2 in the top right-hand corner, right? The twin sons of Tatooine. Now, even in his original version of A New Hope, he fixed that. And then in the high-def version, he fixed it again, so they're a lot clearer, right? And I looked at that, and I thought, I disagree with that because that then takes away the moment when Luke first looks at the two sons, right, on Tatooine. He walks out with the big music going on. He looks at, and you see two sons. You go, shit, man, there's two sons. How cool is that? Based on his version, you're now seeing them ahead of time, and they look exactly as they do in the movie. Actually, it's like that for you guys, right? And even though it's in the top right-hand corner, and I disagree with that because I thought, hang on, the moment is gone. It's like, oh, there's two suns there. So when you look at Luke later on looking at the two suns, there's no magic. It's like, okay, we already know there's two suns. So there's an example where I can imagine someone going in and going, you know what, I'm going to remove that change and get rid of the suns from his version because it helps with the impact later on when Luke sees the two suns for the very first time. So there you go. Jedi Rocks. Yeah, I understand that's getting changed as well. PJ, I'm not sure what the deal is with that. So, and removing Yub Nub from Jedi was a bad decision. Yeah, so, yes. So, and that's the thing. Once people start dicking around with these things and you go, you know, this is great, but I don't agree with that, fine, I'll go back and change my own version. So, who knows where the wind's going to take us. So, there you go. There you go. So as I said, you start then filming new bits to go, you know, now that we're like, we started down this path, let's film our own bridging scenes and make the film like 4 hours longer. So there you go.
Yeah. Well, I think at the end of that, you could be forgiven for not loving one version or another, but at least if you love one version, that's better than anything else. So.
Well, that was one of the things with the Phantom Edits. The guy didn't film anything. He just cut stuff out and rearranged bits, right, and using existing footage. And I think that quite works, as did the specialized edition version. And I do believe that if you can track that down and find it, that is easily put on a HD TV and is just magic to watch because for all intents and purposes, it's the actual film, right? And that is a labor of love that I definitely support. So, there you go.
Yeah.
Very good.
All right, I think we've concluded that we love one version or another, and if you can find it, that would be awesome. Pity they're not more readily available, so, but maybe in the future they will be.
What were you going to say?
Nothing. I was going to move on to the next topic. Go for it. No, finish it off, dude. It's all right.
No, I was going to say, we've still got 14 people watching, so I reckon we can play on for a little bit longer if you want.
All right. How about we take a step down from the brain activity and just you guys can watch and see what happens next. So I will start that again. Daggy, if you could please share my screen. For those who are in the know, Lego is all around us, and some of the pieces that are coming out for 2020, some of these have come out already or just come out, and some of these are coming out, and you might find some of these very interesting. I certainly have. I haven't given you the entire list of what's coming out because that could take forever, and it's probably about as long as cutting a revisited edition.
Well, speaking of cutting, I like this comment from Aaron. This is to do with Phantom Menace, Attack of the Clones, and Revenge of the Sith. I have heard that someone's done this, put them all into one film, and apparently it's actually quite good. So, that's kind of groovy. Continue on.
I will have to find out where that is. So Lego, that is coming out this year. There are some interesting things, and what I've done is I've taken the sets that I've found, and like I said, I'm not showing you everything that's coming out because that would just be too much. I've taken a selection of them, and I've put them in film order just to make things interesting, okay, rather than jumping up and down and backwards or forwards. So in terms of what we've got, there are some of the pieces that you're going to see throughout the coming 6 more months or so. How's this? Anakin, you are my brother! The scene on Mustafar where they're fighting. Now, this is one of the sets that they've started doing where they do a battle scene between a couple of different characters. There's Darth Maul, Obi-Wan, and Qui-Gon. There's one later on you'll see with Vader and Luke.
Yeah, dude. So do you get a cigarette lighter and stick it under Anakin?
Oh, you could. You could melt him down, just chuck him in front of the heater or put him on the stove, whatever you want. But that's the complete little set. And if you really want to put it on something, you could maybe get yourself a lava cake and have it running down melted chocolate or something just to make it interesting.
I have seen, I saw a picture just recently of Anakin's toasting away, burning away on Mustafar, and Obi-Wan sitting there with like roasting marshmallows on him. I reckon that was quite funny. Anyway.
So that's part of their battle sets. The next one, now this is a bit of a confusing one because it's the homestead of Obi-Wan, but it almost looks like in actual fact, Obi-Wan lives in a cave. This looks like the Lars homestead, doesn't it?
He lives in a hovel, not a cave, so there you go.
Okay.
You see in the movie, he's freestanding above the thing and he got the Lancerbeater parked out the front.
Oh, okay. I always thought it was part of the cave structure. See, there you go. No. Learn something new every day. This has got your Tusken Raider, and the really cool part about this is if you have a look in the center, there's a translucent blue little figure, which is the hologram of Leia.
Oh, there you go.
So, although Obi-Wan looks a little young there, I think even with the little gray mustache, he still looks young. And apparently, Tusken Raiders just walk around with what looks like periscopes. Now, because it's the 40th anniversary of Empire, and in actual fact, this was a set that they sort of brought out a little late last year, but it's coming out this year, I think. It's the 20th anniversary of Lego, Star Wars Lego, that came out in 1999 with Episode 1. This is part of the smaller ranges. So if you don't want the large, massive, big AT-ATs that they're bringing out worth hundreds and hundreds of dollars, this could be one of those things that you build and stick on your desk. And I think they're really cool because if you have a look, they're very small little parts. They tell the story very clearly and concisely, and they're just fun to sort of play with.
PJ made a point of saying there's blue milk in Obi-Wan's hut. Yeah, I sort of thought of that, saw that as well, unless it was the hologram. So there you go. Very good.
So there's a few more of these sets that they've been bringing out and will be bringing out, I think. And they're nice little, like, I'd get these and put them on my desk. This is the one that I'm really waiting for. I haven't seen anything other than these pictures, so I don't know when it's coming out. It's the best been seen. And I got to say, it's a very nice little piece.
Here's one for you. See in the bit where Luke's hanging on the gantry and Vader's standing there saying, you know, Luke, you can destroy the Emperor. He's first seen this and that. In the original version of the movie, Darth Vader's helmet wobbles in the wind. Even in the revisited version, he fixed that up. So it's like, as you do. There's no more wobble. Yeah.
And I think the best part with this, because the minifigures are so many different pieces, you can actually pull the hand off and throw that away. So have a look at that. I don't know when this one's coming out, but I think this is going to be one of those collector pieces for the fans. And if you have a really close look, you do.
You're going to say, oh, you can pull the hand of Luke and it will let you go, no, that's not true. That's impossible.
Anyway. If you have a look down the bottom, underneath Luke, there's a three-pronged part. Now, for those who know their Lego, that's a pitchfork, just painted grey. So in terms of part changes, that's actually quite interesting.
Darren has said, will you lose value opening them? Absolutely. And PJ said, apparently it's available in Toys R Us in Canada only. So there you go. Which means they've still got stores over there. How good is that? So,
yeah. Yeah. Mm. All right. Well, PJ, you'll have to grab us one when you get online. Now, these helmets have come out. They're still out, but they go very quickly. And if you remember a couple of months ago, I think when the first one came out, which in the background is the Boba Fett, there is the TIE Fighter. So deceptively nice. They're a little bit of a long build. I found them to be a good 90 minutes plus, but it's actually quite a nice sort of helmet. And these are the only three that have come out so far. I'm not a fan of the Stormtrooper. It looks a little weird. Actually, I think it looks more like one of the new troopers from the sequel series. But the other two are quite good.
PJ made a mention about September the 1st is Razor Crest. So for those out there who have no idea what that is, do you know what that is, MPS?
Yes, and I'll show you a picture of it very shortly.
Very good.
Catherine, the price of these helmets are about $90 at the Lego store, but you can get them at some toy shops, and EB Games did have them for a while, so you still might be able to find them. And that's what the three of them look like side by side. Now, the big UCS project for this year was the A-Wing Starfighter, and it's only a small piece. It's not like the Millennium Falcon, which was 5,725 parts. This is only 1,673 pieces. So it's probably the smallest of the fleet of these. There was a Y-Wing, a TIE Fighter, the Falcon, and a Star Destroyer or Super Star Destroyer from memory. But this is the smallest one of the fleet of these ships. And it is quite nice. I think it's probably meant to be for minifig size. So if you see on the top picture, there is the minifigure pilot sitting there, and I think he fits in there quite nicely. I especially like the engines at the back on the bottom picture. They look like they've been lit up.
There was a thing on the news a few months ago, I think it was, saying like big popular sales over Christmas. So I think it might have been Christmas. I can't remember what it was. And they said apparently one of the big sellers of the top four was actually the really large Star Destroyer at $1,000-something. And apparently that was in the top four of big sellers. God, how insane is that? So there you go.
Well, remembering over here that the Millennium Falcon's a $1,300 price tag, and the Super Star Destroyer I think is $1,100.
Yeah, but I mean the fact that it's in the top four of the best sellers, that's a lot of thousands of dollars that are getting chucked out there for Star Destroyer parts. So anyway, continue.
Yeah. Now, they've re-released this one, and I had a gripe about this or something very similar to this a few weeks ago, but we'll get to that in a second. The Royal Throne, which is called the Death Star Final Duel. Now, this has got a nice little bit to it. Your Royal Guards, your Emperor, your Luke, and your Vader, and it's a set in the throne room. Now,
hang on, isn't the royal throne like the Dunny in Buckingham Palace?
It is. Now, this is the set that came out like 2 years ago, and this is my gripe. It's only been slightly modified, and they've brought it out again, and it really just bugs me when they just do it, because I think to myself, it's done, do something different, not let's do it all over again, or do it right the first time, simple as that. Now, that's a comparison of the two pieces, and this is like a revisited edition, you know, where you put in stuff that didn't work. So top picture has two red windows at the top window, and the bottom one does not. And they've actually flipped the two pieces over.
That's a good question from PJ. Like in Rise of Skywalker, is there's that room there at the bottom, you know, we can go in there and discover like a dark ray hiding in the corner.
That's the extended piece that you can put on yourself, PJ. And you can tear the place apart and throw it across the room and damage it and do whatever to make it look battle damaged.
You need to do the Kef Beer version of this where you smash it to the pieces. It's been crashed. So, yes.
But this is the sort of thing that bugs me about these sort of things. You know, you do one version, then you do another version. Just do it once and do something different. Now, the A-Wing in Australia with the Lego store up at Doncaster, you bought that and you got this set as a freebie. And this is a nice little trench run for the second Death Star. And again, it's one of those micro pieces that you can sort of sit on your desk. And I think that would look really good if you had a couple of those sort of back to back and, you know, a couple of X-Wings in there and that sort of thing.
Pretty good.
There you go, the Razor Crest. Now, for those who were at Brickvention this year in January, someone had the plans and customized it even further, a large scale one. And I tell you what, it was 2 foot long at least for memory, and it was massive. Now, this is not so big. This is probably only about 12 to 16 inches long, I would imagine. It comes with the five figures, including, if you have a look down there, there's four figures, the IG, I can't remember his number, IG 11?
11.
Yep. 11. One biker scout who can slap the baby around, Mandalorian, and I keep thinking that this is like Lando, but it's not Lando. I can't remember his name. PJ, can you tell me the name of that character, please? But what's really cool, this is a pretty small little ship, because I can tell by the size of certain parts that it's actually quite small. But what's really cool is if you have a look right in the middle, there's the child just sitting there, all cutesy.
I just realized if you take the guns off the ship and you could rebox it as the Firefly.
Yeah, you could. Yeah, you pretty much could.
I was only joking, so there you go.
And to go with that, you can bust up a bunch of Mandalorians. So they bring out a set of miscellaneous Mandalorians. If you really want to, you can spray paint a few different colors on them, and you've got a whole bunch of dudes that you can just kill and just leave lying around. Now, this is going to be one of the big sellers. It's the Brickheads. Now, these are small little 3-inch high type sets where they're characters, and they've done a range of characters from superheroes to I can't remember the rest of them, but there's a range of these things. And obviously the child, and that'll be probably the biggest seller of the lot. They'll get it just for that. And I think the price for this is about $30, maybe $35.
The Mandalorian's helmet almost looks like a Cylon or something, doesn't it? It looks very, very robotic.
Yeah. Well, because of the size of it and the limitation of pieces, yeah, that's the one probably problem with it. You could maybe do it a different way, but it might look rectangular if you put two smaller pieces in there.
Yeah, the dude you look talking about was Grief Karga. Yes, that was Carl Weathers. Yep.
And that's the set of the two. So it looks like the baby is floating in this little cribby thing. Now, I haven't read much about this, and I will find out for next time, but apparently Star Wars Lego are doing a holiday special. Now, what that is exactly, I don't know. Further details are to come. But I thought, that'll be interesting. I have the feeling, though, it's going to be done with the sequel trilogy, so Rey and and Finn and those guys, but I'm not 100% sure. But I will find out more for you for next time. Very and that good. Is it.
How good is that? Wow, there you go.
So that's only that's only some of the Lego that's coming out this year. There is more sets, but, you know, we could be here for another hour, I guess.
I could see people having to sell their kidneys online, you know, or a lung or two just to try and pay for some of this stuff. So bloody crazy. So
yeah.
There you go.
So, yeah.
Very good.
Now, I think that's all we've got time for tonight, unless we've got other notes or something to make mention of.
I don't know, unless anybody's got any questions they want to ask that is interesting. I like, because I made a reference to the Mandalorian looking like a Cylon, I like what PJ said, you know, by the Child's Command. I reckon that was kind of grimace.
Actually, it'd be probably Child's Command by the, when it actually does speak, because it's backwards language.
Oh, yeah, exactly right. So there you go. But it's good. There's a lot of good stuff going on out there. So there you go.
Yeah, so and there are obviously other things going on in terms of merchandise, but the Lego stuff is now in its 21st year since it started back in 1999 with Phantom Menace Lego. And that was interesting to see when that all came out. So it's gotten bigger.
Yeah.
Maybe not better, but it's certainly gotten bigger. You know, the pieces have definitely got bigger.
Yeah. Here we go. Things are getting so bad that Darren Collins has chucked in a Star Trek reference. Dude, there's no swearing on this show.
Oh, we can talk about that when we're back to our regularly scheduled program next week, perhaps. So,
yeah, exactly right. So there you go.
But I think in the meantime, with Star Wars out and open things as well, that was certainly interesting.
I'm just going to put it out there for everybody. For those who don't know, MPS actually is a collector of Royal Guard merchandise, and he has a glass cabinet all set up with Royal Guard related stuff. And I've seen a lot of Star Wars collections all over the place from various people and various things and very specialized ones. And he's definitely one of the better ones that I've seen in terms of something that's very, very specialized. And the way it's been displayed is very, very cool. So at some point, MPS, you'll probably have to put some photos up or something so people can sort of see what it's all about, because it definitely is worthy of having a good look at.
I will in a couple of months' time. I've got a project that I'm working on that I'm keeping a little bit under the radar, and if it works out, you'll definitely see the collection. So
the Vial has mentioned about the Rise of Skywalker comic, which is extended. That would make sense, Mr. Vial, because comics like the novelizations are usually based on the original screenplay because they're done ahead before the movie's released. And as a result, they end up putting bits in that become deleted scenes later on. So that's the reason, if you ever want to find the full story of something, they're the ones you sort of look at and you go, hang on, where's this bit here in the movie? It was cut out. It may have even been filmed in a lot of cases. Occasions they do actually film these things and just remove them later on. So I'm not surprised that there are extended scenes in the comic as there would be in the novelization. So there you go. How good's that?
There you go.
Very good. So there you go. Good stuff.
And as I mentioned, we're back to our normal. What do we got next week, dude? Sci-Fi Zone. That's right.
Talk nerdy to me. Yeah, we're talking nerdy next week. So there you go. In fact, there may be a Star Trek conversation coming up next week. You just never know. So there you go.
But in the meantime, I think we will end tonight. We've had a bit of fun. We've had certainly a lot to think about. And we will bring this up next month. Yes.
I just thought of something. So what you people can do out there, if you want, you can actually download this episode from Facebook, download it, and then add your own bits in and make your own revisited version. Now, if you want to fix the mistakes from this show, cut one of us two out and we'll just make it quiet or whatever, and you could actually do we've got Mos Eisley Monthly Revisited and just fix up the errors that were anything that we've said that is incorrect, you can sort it out and make a better version of it. So how good is that?
And then someone can get that version and put it back to the original with all the mistakes included in a high def.
Yeah, exactly right. Who knows the Mos Eisley used to be there? Yeah, it's in Kilda. Good on. Yeah, very good. So there you go. So we're finishing up.
I think on that note, we'll leave you for this evening. May the Force be with you.
But not with me.
Always.
Okay.
See you guys.
Catch you next month. Okay, bye.